Good morning. Welcome.
Morning.
Happy Easter. He is risen.
Indeed.
Indeed. He is risen indeed. At this time, if you would, let's all please stand. 367, your hymnals. Hopefully, Brother Mark will have it up here on the screen. Christ the Lord is risen today.
Christ the Lord is risen today, alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high, alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply, alleluia. Lives again our glorious King, alleluia. Where, O death, is thou thy sting?
Father, Lord, we just thank you that we do serve a risen Savior. Lord, the disciples, Mary, the women from Galilee, all saw you. There was 500 more brothers, Lord. It's in history, Father. We serve a risen Savior. Lord, we just thank you. We're going to the cross, the perfect sacrifice, taking sins past, sins then, and sins in the future, and laying them all on yourself. Lord, we love you and we just thank you for the hope that we have in knowing you. Be with us now, Lord, and forgive us where we fail thee. For it's in Jesus' precious name we pray. Amen. Announcements.
Y'all may be seated, by the way.
I'm sorry. I have proof. Remember, is it Frank? Frank, he brought me a reminder. He says, I listened to your announcement. Remember when I was kidding with the kids? Any peanuts? Because we weren't allowed to have peanuts. Frank got me a whole bag of peanuts. Woo! Thank you, brother. Okay. Hazard construction for flood relief, April the 26th through the 28th, right around the corner. It's family friendly, meals and lodging included, skills helpful but not required. Sign up today. You can see Jarrett or Emily Kenner. They're around here somewhere. Not here. Okay. Next Sunday night, we have a guest speaker. Thank you, Florentine Clipa from Outreach Romania. Love offering will be collected for his ministry. That's next Sunday night. Okay. Family bingo night. Friday, April the 12th at 6:30 p.m. You're going to have dots? No. No. Sign up on the bulletin board. Bring your favorite appetizer. If you don't want to play bingo, there will be other games available. I used to coon hunt with a guy, and his wife loved to play bingo. But Oscar Chadwick would never say bingo. Oscar, how's your wife doing? Oh, it's that woman, I tell you what, she's out there playing that bingo. Just bingo, bingo, bingo. That's all she does, play bingo. She loves that bingo. Whoa, here's something we need to do. Family hiking outing, Saturday, April the 20th. Meet at Pioneer Baptist Church at 7 a.m. Bus leaving at 7:15. Cove Spring Park in Frankfort, Kentucky. Lunch is provided. Sign up on the bulletin board. Vacation Bible School, June the 2nd through the 6th. Volunteer sign up and t-shirts sign up on the bulletin board. Volunteers need to sign up ASAP. You know what that means? As soon as possible. Very good. I love acronyms, don't you? So we know what areas will need to be filled. Any questions, see Lane Simpson. Lane Simpson, I saw him earlier this morning. Where's he at? Right there. Lane's right here in the front row. With the kids. Y'all like Lane? You're on the fence, Lane. Annie Armstrong. Our goal is 1,500, so we've met more than half the goal. Please use Annie Armstrong envelopes provided at the welcome desk or by the brown box on each side of the sound booth back there. Okay, next we have a video, correct, Mark? Oh, we're going to do the, okay. At this time, we'll receive our tithes and offering as the ushers come from the rear of the sanctuary. Thank you all. Thank you.
This tree is over 300 feet tall, estimated to be at least 600 years old. And that's nothing. There are trees towering over this forest that were just seedlings when Christ was walking on the earth. How deep do you think the roots are on a tree like this? 100 feet? 1,000 feet? The truth is, a tree this tall can't grow roots deep enough to support itself. That is why redwoods have intertwining roots. They support one another. These trees literally do for each other what they can't do alone. I think Jesus demonstrated that same mindset for us, that we're all in this together, supporting one another. I mean, think about it. He never just passed somebody by leaving them stuck. Jesus was constantly intertwining his life with those he came in contact with. He called people out of obscurity to join him in his journey of changing the world. He healed a blind man with mud. He restored a chronically ill outcast with merely the hem of his garment. He renewed one woman's hope for second chances and reminded a Pharisee of his need for mercy instead of morality. Jesus' ministry was constantly intertwined with people, connecting with them on the most intimate levels and changing their lives forever. Jesus called his followers to love people the way that he loved them, to bring health to the sick, raise the dead, cast out demons, touch the untouchables, and as you have been treated generously, so live generously. And that call hasn't expired. Yeah. His charge to the church is just as clear today as ever. Therefore, may we be rooted in Christ, intertwined with one another, so that we may continue his mission.
Up Calvary's mountain, one dreadful morn, walked Christ my Savior, weary and worn, facing for sinners death on the cross, that he might save them from endless loss. Blessed Redeemer, precious Redeemer, seems now I see him on Calvary's tree, wounded and bleeding, for sinners pleading, blind and unheeding, dying for me. Father, sinners pleading, blind and unheeding. Precious Redeemer, seems now I see him on Calvary's tree, wounded and bleeding, for sinners pleading, blind and unheeding, dying for me. Blessed Redeemer, precious Redeemer, seems now I see him on Calvary's tree, wounded and bleeding, for sinners pleading, blind and unheeding, dying for me.
All stand together as we think about the cross. Aren't you glad there's an empty grave? Let's sing Man of Sorrows together.
debt is paid. It is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free indeed. Now my debt is paid. It is paid in full by the precious blood that my Jesus spilled. Now the curse of sin has no hold on me. Whom the Son sets free, oh, is free.
An empty tomb. He is the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. And that's what this song is all about. Let's sing it for His glory today.
In the darkness we were waiting, without hope, without light. Till from heaven you came running, there was mercy in your eyes. To fulfill the law and prophets, to a virgin came the word. From a throne of endless glory, to a cradle in the dirt.
Despise the cross, for even in your suffering you saw to the other side, knowing this was our salvation. Jesus, for our sake you died. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one, God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings. its breath, till that stone was moved for good, for the Lamb had conquered death. And the dead rose from their tombs, and the angels stood in awe, for the souls of all who come to the Father are restored.
The church of Christ was born,
then the Spirit lit the flame. Now this gospel truth of old shall not kneel, shall not faint. By his blood and in his name, in his freedom I am free. For the love of Jesus Christ, who has resurrected me. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Spirit, three in one. God of glory, majesty, praise forever to the King of Kings.
This time we want to invite the children to go down to Children's Church. All those working with them, go with them too. If you've got new children, make sure you sign them in so that they can find their way back to their parents. And ladies and gentlemen, y'all can be seated. We'll let y'all do that.
Tell you, it's my favorite Sunday. Aren't you glad we get to celebrate an empty tomb? That is such a wonderful blessing. You know, several years ago, there was a little series that came out that Marvel put out. Y'all remember the Marvel movies, right? Remember when those were the biggest thing in town? And around that time, they came up with Disney Plus, right? And then they had their own Marvel section on Disney Plus, and in that Marvel section, the Marvel people came out with a thing that they called What If. Anybody watch the What If shows? Am I the only? Thank you. Thank you. Somebody else is watching. What If? And what these things would do is they would take the different characters from all the Marvel movies and they'd say, what if? Like they said, what if it hadn't been Steve that got all the Captain America juice and it had been his girlfriend instead, right? And so they did a whole show on that, and it didn't change much. What if Doctor Strange kept trying to save his girlfriend from dying over and over and over again and wouldn't just let her pass? What if, and what if, and what if? They asked all these questions of what if. A lot of times the consequences were tragic. Sometimes they actually had some positive consequences. But all they did was, each one pointed towards the reality that one small change would make if it had happened a little bit different. Today we want to ask that question in respect to why we are here today. The celebration of an empty tomb. What if? What if Jesus was still in the tomb? It's not easy to think about. But what if that was the reality? Today we want to talk about that. Now the things we're going to talk about, we don't even have to speculate because the Bible covers that. It talks about what would have happened or what would be different if the resurrection weren't real. What if Jesus did not rise from the dead? Scripture itself looks at that question, and though there are some that want to deny the resurrection, even during the times of the Bible writers, by the way, there's still many today, you don't have to look far, people that profess to be Christians that deny the physical resurrection of Jesus Christ, saying it was just a spiritual thing, something that happened in the hearts of the disciples. It didn't really occur. But Scripture doesn't teach that. And Scripture talks about what would happen, what would it be like if Jesus were still in the grave. In 1 Corinthians 15, Paul writes these words in verse 12 to the church in Corinth. Now, if Christ is proclaimed as raised from the dead, how can some of you say there is no resurrection of the dead? If there is no resurrection of the dead, then not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, then our proclamation is in vain, and so is your faith. Moreover, we are found to be false witnesses about God, because we have testified wrongly about God that he raised him up from the dead, whom he did not raise up, if in fact the dead are not raised. For if the dead are not raised, not even Christ has been raised. And if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. You are still in your sins. Those then who have fallen asleep in Christ have also perished. If we have put our hope in Christ for this life only, we should be pitied more than anyone. Let's pray. Father, today we ask that you remind us of the importance of the resurrection, that today we would not take it for granted, but as we contemplate what life might be like without a resurrection, that you, Lord, would stir within us a new desire to experience the fullness of your resurrection. So, Lord, we thank you. We praise you that your Spirit is here to speak to us. We pray that you will guide us in truth as we take this journey together. And we ask, what if? In Jesus' name, amen. Today, God wants us to know that the resurrection changes everything. But for us to know that, to come to that reality, I want us to contemplate, what would it be like if Jesus had not raised from the dead? If Jesus had not been raised from the dead, our culture would be totally different. And I want you to know, as we begin, I want to take a little bit of time to point out that the influence that the church has had on our culture. Now, I want to admit, and we all have to admit this, there have been many evil things the church that has happened through the church over the centuries. Evil things have been done in the name of Jesus. Evil things have been done that have influenced and impacted the world, and it's a tragedy. And I want you to know, I don't try to bridge over that, wash over that, and act like those things never occurred. But I do believe this. Evil men will do evil things whether they have the church or not. These evil men would have done these evil things even if the church had not existed, because evil men do evil things. So I don't think it would necessarily change that there would be less evil if the church hadn't existed, because evil people would still do those evil things. But what I do want us to understand is that as we look at this, there were some positive things that the church, some positive things that the church had on our culture as well, before we get into the nuts and bolts of the theology behind it. We need to understand the impact that it had on art. The church did incredible things. When we went to Rome, that was so exciting. We went with my kids. Sarah was not able to go with us, but me and the kids, other rest of the kids, and Angela went with my brother-in-law and sister-in-law. They're getting ready to go back to Europe with their another brother-in-law and sister-in-law, and they're going to bypass Rome because they've already been there. I'm like, I would go back to Rome yesterday. There is so much to see in Rome. We were there, and we only got to spend a brief moment of one day in the Vatican City, you know, and go into St. Peter's Basilica. And I can still remember walking into St. Peter's Basilica. And as we walked in, I looked over to the right, and I saw this thing over in the corner. And I was like, is that the Pieta? And I turned and I walked over there and I looked and I was like, I've seen this thing. I've studied about this thing. I've heard about this thing for 20, 30 years. I never dreamed I'd see it live and in person. And there it was. Michelangelo, as he did this piece, this is the only piece, evidently, that he ever signed. Is it Michelangelo? It is Michelangelo, right? I think it was Michelangelo that did this. Michelangelo, I guess. Maybe I'm not pronouncing it right. But anyway, it's the only piece he ever signed. The Pieta means the pity. And as we look at this, we are reminded of all the great things. Later that day, we went and we saw the Sistine Chapel. That beautiful thing we'd heard about and saw those pictures up on the ceiling and just marveled and sat. I think we sat in there for over half an hour just trying to soak it all in and look at all the things that have been done. And listen to this quote I found in an article by Tudor Chase website. It said, the church has been a major patron of the arts since the early Christian era, commissioning works of art and architecture that reflect its teachings and values. This patronage has had a profound influence on the development of Western art and architecture, shaping the aesthetic and thematic direction of these fields for centuries. In the Renaissance, the church continued to be a major patron of the arts. In the Middle Ages, too, commissioning works from some of the era's most renowned artists, including Michelangelo and Raphael. These artists created paintings, sculptures, and architectural designs that were deeply influenced by Christian themes and values. The church patronage during the period helped to foster the development of new artistic techniques and styles, such as perspective and naturalism. There has been an incredible impact on our culture in an artistic way. But imagine if the Pieta, the pity we just saw, was where it ended. If the sealed tomb is the end of the story of Jesus, you know, we wouldn't even know who he was. We'd never have heard of Jesus. He would have been one of the 100 to 150,000 individuals that were crucified on the cross by the Romans, lost, nameless. We wouldn't have known his story. He would have been a little blip in the radar of history if he was still in the grave. I promise you that. Not only that, we've been blessed with art and architecture, but also the impact in music. Like many of the artists, composers were commissioned by the church to write some of the most beautiful compositions ever written. My favorite, The Messiah, right? I mean, what would life be like without the Hallelujah chorus? I mean, what would it be like? And in modern music, as much as I've loved my rock and my pop music growing up, and believe me, I have a collection of albums from those days, it did very little to lift me up. Singing She Loves Me, Yeah, Yeah, Yeah. Eventually you realize life is more than dust in the wind, don't you? Music, it's had an impact on music. And I don't know about you, but I would rather sing the songs we sang this morning than any of those songs I loved growing up when I was listening to the radio. Then there's many charities of churches that minister to people benevolently, whether it's the homeless, the hungry, the naked, the orphans, and helping with utilities. The first orphanage set up in the state of Kentucky was formed by the WMU in Louisville, Kentucky, who said there's a lot of kids out here after the Civil War that don't have parents, and we need to make sure they're taken care of. And Sunrise, what is now Sunrise Children's Home, was established to care for those orphans before the state ever came up with any idea for foster care. This is an area that we can obviously improve on. There's so many needs out there, so many that are unloved. But you know what? As I was trying to find out some sort of total. There's so many churches that are doing so many ministries. There's no way to add all of those things together. But here's the interesting thing I found. I found that in many cities, churches are being fined because they're feeding the hungry. Cities are trying to stop caring for the homeless in their cities because of of what it does to property values, because of the influence of having the poor in their communities has. These changes in the world are nothing compared to the impact of our lives spiritually if the resurrection had never happened. First, if Jesus had never been raised from the dead, know this, Jesus is a false prophet. If Jesus was never raised from the dead, he was a liar. He lied about who he was. My friend Andy McDonald, who came and preached revival for us, when he talks to people about Jesus, he tells them the story of Jesus, and then he says, to prove he was who he said he was, he rose from the dead. Friends, that was the proof. That was the proof that he was the Son of God. And if he wasn't the Son of God, and he wasn't raised from the dead, he was a liar and a false prophet. All thoughts about Jesus being a good teacher and a good man go out the window if Jesus is not raised from the dead. Jesus said they will kill him, and on the third day he will be raised up, and they were deeply depressed. He doubled down on that, on his prophecy later in Matthew when he preached, they will hand him over to the Gentiles to be mocked, flogged, and crucified, and on the third day he will be raised. Over and over and over again in the Gospels, we see Jesus predicting his death, burial, and resurrection. He was so outspoken about it, his enemies knew about the prophecies. And they asked Pilate, let's station a guard outside, let's bind up the tomb, let's seal it so that no one can come and steal the body of Jesus. That's how much they were afraid of it, because they said, this will become the greatest lie of all if he is found with an empty tomb. They understood the importance of a resurrection, and they wanted to make sure it couldn't happen as if they could stop it. They understood the message of Jesus would stay buried with Jesus in the grave as long as his body never left that tomb. God declared through Moses, when a prophet speaks in the Lord's name and the message does not come true or is not fulfilled, that is a message the Lord has not spoken. The prophet has spoken it presumptuously. Do not be afraid of him. If Jesus is still in the grave, he is a false prophet, plain and simple. No wonder Paul said that if Christ has not been raised, your faith is worthless. It's worthless. If we have put our hope in Christ for this life only, we should be pitied more than anyone. Do you understand that? Now I want to examine my life, how my life would be different. And I ask you to do that as I recount how my life would be different if Jesus weren't alive. Think about your life. How would your life be different if Jesus was not raised from the dead? My life would be different. I would have never met Angela. There was no resurrection. There'd never been a Baptist Student Union. We would have never had our paths cross. These last 35 years would have probably been started with someone else, and to be honest, I'd probably be divorced at least once by now. There's no resurrection. I wouldn't know what it's like to have a wife that loves me unconditionally. A wife that will sacrificially serve me as she has these last 6-7 weeks. She's been working so hard. Worse yet, were there no resurrection, I would never know how to love that way. I'd be a sad, miserable, lonely person if it weren't for the resurrection. Why do I say that? 1 John 4:7-8 says, friends, let us love one another, because love is from God, and everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. The one who does not love does not know God, because God is love. I would not know what love is without the resurrection. You know where this is going, don't you? I would never have had any of my children. No, I might have had other children, I wouldn't have had these children. Because I never would have married Angela. Some of you may say, well, how do you know you wouldn't have married them? I mean, y'all both went to Western Kentucky University. Listen, it took me 6 years to convince her to date me as a Christian. You think she ever would have dated me as a pagan? When I told her what I was thinking about preaching and how things would be different if the resurrection never occurred, she said, well, first off, you wouldn't have married me. I mean, she let me know my point, right? She's just flat out told me, if you didn't have Jesus, forget you, man. Not only that, I wouldn't have met y'all. Never met any of you. I wouldn't know the love that I've felt since I've been here at Piner if it weren't for the resurrection. In fact, it's safe to say that nearly every other person in my life that has any kind of positive influence in me, except for my immediate family, my mom, my stepfather, and my sisters, and my stepbrothers and stepsisters, everyone else will be totally different in my life today. And I wouldn't have as many either. Why did I say that? Jesus said, I tell you, there is no one who's left house or brothers, sisters or mother, father or children, or fields for my sake and for the sake of the gospel, who will not receive 100 times more now at this time, houses, brothers, sisters, mothers, and children, and fields with persecutions and eternal life in the age to come. My life would be totally different. But it wouldn't stop there. It wouldn't stop in my circle of influence. It wouldn't stop with not knowing any of you. It wouldn't stop with not having my family. It would continue on. I would be still in my sin. I would still be trapped in a sinful personhood. And yes, I know I don't live a perfect life. I know that sin still sometimes wins a victory. But I cannot imagine without the resurrection what my life would be like, what kind of man I would be, because I know how sinful I am. And 1 Corinthians 6:9-11 says, don't you know that the unrighteous will not inherit God's kingdom? Do not be deceived. No sexually immoral people, idolaters, adulterers, or males who have sex with males, no thieves, greedy people, drunkards, verbally abusive people, or swindlers will inherit God's kingdom. And some of you used to be like this, but you were washed. You were sanctified. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. Without Jesus, I'd still be trapped in sin. I know some of my weaknesses. Y'all don't know them. I know I have an addictive personality, that I can get hooked on anything like that. Whether it's playing video games on my phone, playing fantasy football, if I'm not careful, those things will grab hold of me, swallow me up, and captivate me and capture every single thought of my life. Because I got Jesus, it's things like fantasy football or playing games. Without Jesus, it'd be a lot worse. I'd be addicted to pornography, I have no doubt in my mind, because I fought that battle even with him. And I know I would have lost that battle without him. I'd be addicted to pornography. I'd probably be an alcoholic, because when I was fighting that battle, I found myself being very easily drinking the hard stuff. I didn't need to fool with the beer and stuff. I found myself drawn to the harder liquor, and it did not influence me. I know I was on my way to alcoholism without Jesus being the Lord of my life. Gambling, probably wouldn't have been far behind it. So I'd be hooked on pornography, alcohol, and gambling. Who knows what else would have grabbed hold of me? A lonely, broke, addicted man is probably where I'd be headed. I'm just being honest with you. If it weren't for the resurrection, you know your weaknesses. Where would you be? Some of you may be there because the resurrection hasn't been real in your life yet. Not only that, I'd have no hope. I'd be trapped in that lifestyle with no hope of getting out of it. I'd be sitting there all by myself, lonely, miserable, angry at the world, blaming everything, everyone else for what's going on wrong in my life because I had self-destructed without Jesus in my life. Without the resurrection, there's no forgiveness, no washing or sanctification, no justification. I'd have no hope. I'd be trapped in my sinful life with no chance of deliverance. Scripture makes it very clear. Our hope flows from Jesus through the resurrection. Look what Peter wrote. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Because of his great mercy, he has given us new birth in a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead. We wouldn't have that new birth. We wouldn't have that living hope were it not for the resurrection. And then we have an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading that is kept in heaven for you. I'd have none of that were it not for an empty grave. No mercy, no birth, no hope, no inheritance, no heaven. Know what I'd have? I'd be destined for eternity in hell. I know that's where I'd be headed. Jesus spoke about the realities of hell. And he reminded us more often than he spoke of the glory of heaven. Mark 9:47-48, he said, if your eye causes you to fall away, gouge it out. It is better for you to enter the kingdom of God with one eye than to have two eyes and be thrown into hell, where the worm does not die and the fire is not quenched. In Revelation, it says, death and Hades were thrown into the lake of fire. This is the second death, the lake of fire. And anyone whose name was not found in the book of life was thrown into the lake of fire. By the way, no resurrection, no book of life. Hell would be there for us all. Luke 16, we read the most graphic description of it as Jesus tells the parable. I don't even think it's a parable. I think he tells the story of Lazarus and the rich man. Remember the story? There was a rich man who had all the good stuff and was eating and feasting and having a wonderful time. Outside his gate was Lazarus, who was dying with sores, a poor man that was a beggar that would have loved to have eaten the crumbs that fell off the table to the dogs. Those very dogs would go out and lick the wounds of Lazarus. And then he tells in his story of these two gentlemen. The reason I believe it's a real story is he mentions Lazarus by name. In none of the other parables does he use names of people. Good Samaritan was just a good Samaritan. The man that was beat up was just a man that was beat up. We look at the other parables, there's no names mentioned. But in this one, he mentions the name of the poor man by name. And the rich man looks up and he sees Lazarus at the breast of Abraham because he has died, the rich man has died and has gone into Hades. And here's what it's, Jesus said about him. Being in torment in Hades, he looked up and saw Abraham a long way off with Lazarus at his side. Father Abraham, he called out, have mercy on me and send Lazarus to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, because I am in agony in this flame. How much agony do you need to be in where you think a finger dipped in water would give you relief? That's where I'd be. Without Jesus, without his resurrection, the promise would be out of my reach if it weren't for the resurrection. You see, if the tomb weren't empty, I'd be empty. That's where I'd be. Romans 6:4-5 reminds us, though, of something else. Therefore, we were buried with him by baptism into death, in order that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, so we too may walk in the newness of life. For if we have been united with him in the likeness of his death, we will certainly also be in the likeness of his resurrection. It would be beyond my reach if it weren't for the resurrection, but Jesus has been raised from the dead. Jesus is alive. We have a reason for hope. We have a reason for new life. We have that potential to be delivered from our sins, all because the resurrection is real. The great news is that he is alive. Paul goes through all the bad things that we would not have if there were no resurrection. And then in verse 20, he shares the good news. If your Bibles are still open, look at 20 through 22. 1 Corinthians 15, as it is, Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, the resurrection of the dead also comes through a man. Just as Adam and Adam all die, also in Christ all will be made alive. You see, in spite of all the things I'd be without the resurrection, none of those things are my reality. That's not where I live. What if doesn't matter, because it isn't what is. Because of Jesus' resurrection, I do have deliverance. I do have forgiveness. I do know mercy. I do have hope. I am sanctified. I am justified. I do love, and I am loved. I have a purpose, and I have eternal life. And you can too. You can too. No one has to go to hell. No one has to live there. You can be delivered from that. You remember the story of the rich man and Lazarus? Remember the rich man said, well, at least would you send Lazarus to appear to my family so they won't come here too. If you remember, Abraham said something very interesting. He said, well, they have the law and the prophets. They have everything they need to point them towards the coming Messiah and to believe in him. He said, no, but if someone rose from the dead, they'd believe. Abraham says, even if someone rose from the dead, they wouldn't believe. The irony of that is Jesus did rise from the dead. And the first thing that those priests and Pharisees did was devise an excuse for why he was still dead. They had all the proof they needed of the law and the prophets. They had all the proof they needed from the testimony of the soldiers. And they paid the soldiers off and said, tell someone while you were sleeping, someone stole the body of Jesus. And it was his disciples. I don't know about you, last time I was asleep, I didn't know what was going on around me. Couldn't point a finger at anybody of doing something if I was asleep. But that's the story that got out. But today, the resurrection's real. Today, you can have life. It's a very simple thing you do. You have to admit your sin. You have to admit that if Jesus had not risen from the dead, you'd be a sinful person. You'd still be trapped in your sin. Because you know what? That's exactly where I would be. I don't know if you could identify with that. You may have had other things that would have popped into your mind about the sin you would have had. Maybe some of you would be having affairs with 15 different people. I don't know. I just know where I would be. I am a sinner in need of God's grace, and I can't live by the law and save myself. Jesus came and he lived. He fulfilled the law. He did everything the law demanded of a person and never once sinned, never allowed sin to creep into his life. And you know what else he did? He fulfilled the requirements of the law by becoming the sacrifice for our sins. Sacrifice took the place of the person that was offering it on the altar. When you read in the Old Testament, you see this is graphically demonstrating the fact that whoever would bring the offering to the priest would bring it to them, and then the person would have to say, this lamb is about to die, or this goat is about to die for my sins, and they would be the ones to draw the blood to kill that animal, because they were symbolizing the fact that animal was taking their place on the altar as it was going before God. Jesus was laid on the altar of the cross, and he died for my sins and your sins. The Bible says he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us so that we might become the righteousness of God through Christ Jesus. I want you to know this is being offered to you today. Because the resurrection is real, we know this is our hope. Because he is alive, we know that we can be forgiven of our sins. And not only that, he rose from the dead to prove he was who he said he was. The grave is empty, and it proved that Jesus was the Son of God. It proved that he was indeed the Lamb that was slain before the foundation of the earth. He was raised up to new life, and because of that, we have the confidence and the hope of the resurrection. I want to challenge you today. Admit your sins. Believe in the work of Jesus Christ and confess him as Lord of your life. If you commit to him, the Bible says if you confess Jesus as Lord, believe in your heart, God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. The hope of the resurrection is for you today. You can have life everlasting by trusting and depending upon him. I want to challenge you. Will you live your life in the power of the resurrection? Brothers and sisters in Christ, how is the resurrection making a difference in your life? Are you living the life of one that has been sanctified, who has been made clean through the blood of Christ? Are you living your life for the glory of God? Philippians 3, 10 through 11, Paul writes these words, "My goal is to know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being conformed to his death, assuming that I will somehow reach the resurrection from among the dead." Do you want that today? Do you want that today? Trust in Jesus. Embrace his resurrection power. Let's pray. God, we are so grateful today that the resurrection is true, that the grave is indeed empty, that Jesus rose to life in a physical way. He stood before his disciples. He ate food in front of them to prove it was a physical resurrection. He challenged them to put their hands in the prints of his hands and to touch his side where he had been pierced so that they could feel and know that he was alive before their very eyes in a physical way. He was not a ghost. He was not some sort of illusion. He wasn't some sort of mass hysteria kind of vision that they saw. He was really alive, and he was physically in their presence. Because of that, we know that Jesus is exactly who he said he was, the Son of God. Lord, I pray that today, if there's someone here that has never trusted in him to save them from their sins, that today the resurrection would be real in their lives so that they would respond to him. That, Lord, during this time of invitation, they would come forward and make Jesus Lord of their lives. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. If you're here today, maybe for the first time, you are so convinced of the resurrection, you believe Jesus really is the Son of God. I hope you have. And maybe today you need to come forward and make Jesus Lord. Here's the great promise of Scripture. All who call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. If you call on him today, he will save you from your sins. I want you to know, you will only believe in the resurrection if the Father is drawing you. If he has revealed that truth to you, that's what we need to understand. Do you want to embrace Jesus as Lord today? Please do it before we leave this place. Let's stand together as we sing our hymn of invitation. If God is calling to you, won't you come right now and live for Jesus? Come right now.
For thou in thy atonement did
on Calvary my sin and disgrace. Such love constrains me to answer his call, follow his leading, and give him my all. O Jesus, Lord and Savior, I give myself to thee, for thou in my atonement didst give thyself for me. My life I give henceforth to live, O Christ, for thee alone.
Continue to play. If you're here today and you've never made Jesus Lord of your life, maybe you have questions. Maybe you've got doubts. I'd love to talk to you about how you can be sure that Jesus is alive today, how he can indeed save you from your sins. Here's the reality. If the resurrection of Jesus is real, everything else he says is real. If it's not, the rest of it's a lie. I'm going to be the first to admit that. But I know the resurrection's real. I've experienced its power in my life. I understand and realize that in history it's a historical event. I believe it with my whole heart. I am so confident in that. Sometimes I'm not confident in myself. I'm always confident in Jesus. I know that he is alive. And if you're here today and you've never professed faith in him, I want you to know you can know that too by surrendering to him. Some of you may be saying, well, wait a second, I'm messed up. I'm all those things you said you'd be if you didn't have the resurrection of Christ. I want you to know the only way to escape that is through faith in Jesus. The Bible tells us it is by grace that you are saved through faith, not because of works, lest any man should boast. You cannot save yourself. It is dependent upon faith. It is dependent on trusting in Jesus to be the Savior of your life. He has paid your debt. You can't pay it. He's already paid it. But you have to trust in him. You have to believe in him. If you're here today and you know you're lost, I invite you to come and embrace a resurrected Jesus as Lord of your life and to commit to living for him. Let's sing that next verse.
Living for Jesus wherever I am.
Thank you so much for being here today. If you're here today and you've never made Jesus Lord of your life, or you have questions for me, please contact me. You can contact me, 513-390-1898. Text me. I'll be glad to contact you and talk to you about any questions you have and tell you about why I'm so sure the resurrection is real. I desire for every one of you to be a brother or sister in Christ. I really do. I mean, I want heaven as full as it can possibly be. There's no overcrowding in heaven, folks. There's plenty of room. And we would love for you to know life everlasting. It is a promise that is for each and every one of you who will trust in him. thank you so much for coming today. Great seeing you here. Great having you here. Seeing some faces of folks I haven't seen in a while. Glad to have y'all back. It's always a blessing. But I want you to know something. I really do mean this. I love each and every one of you. You say, well, how can you say that? Because Jesus is alive. He gives me his love. And I know how much he loves you. I love you too. I'm going to ask my brother Bill to come up here. He's going to pray our closing prayer. Then we'll have our closing chorus.
I was not given any written prayer requests. Are there any unspoken requests? By the uplifted hand, okay, thank you. Please pray with me. Father in heaven, the one true God, the God of the living, Father, your Son told us that you are not the God of the dead, but the God of the living. Father, Jesus has brought life, armloads of life to us. And Father, again, if there's one here who have experienced new life in you, I'd ask that they would change that right now. Father, please be with the requests that were made. Father, we thank you for our time together. We give you the glory. In your Son's name we do pray.
If you would, join us in our chorus, He Lives. Listen to these words. He lives,
He lives, He lives.
Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow